Shat Param Brahma Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. We are in Amrutanubhava and in the introduction part, and someone has asked me to touch upon the parokshata, parichinnata and pratyakshata again. So why world? Here it was told, this was the second point, first point about maya. In the introduction, the teacher Jnaneshwar Maharaj, it's our Swami Anubhavananji, he is explaining how misunderstanding about maya creates confusion in our mind, and we have to understand it correctly. So here it says, the various examples used to indicate that the world is an illusion, etc., do not mean that the world is an illusion. Then what is the world?
Maya.
Huh? Essentially, it is the truth. That, see, you have to be very careful there. Where your attention is going. So, world is an illusion means name and form is the illusion. But what the world is made up of is nothing but the truth. So, the name and form of the ornament is an illusion, but what the ornament is, gold only. Like that. So, we are not accessing the truth in the world. But instead, we are getting disturbed by the world. Why we are getting disturbed? Because our attention is not on the essence, but our attention is on the name and form. So here it says, what is meant is a contrary perception of the reality, such as, so why do we not see the world as truth? Because of direct pratyakshata. Pratyakshata is direct perception, that with your eyes you see the world and you start taking it to be real, that yes, it is a world. I see it, I touch it, I feel it. You are at the sensory level, isn't it? Who has come? Come in. You can sit on the top sofa, wherever. Okay, come sit here. So, pratyaksha, aksha means eyes. And pratyaksha means that which is seen by the eyes is pratyakshata, direct perception. And that which is perceived directly is the world for us, isn't it? See? And what is the truth? Can you see the truth directly? Here in the class I told, yes, if you have the intuitive eye, then you can get, you are the truth, isn't it? But here we are saying, the three reasons why we see the world as an illusion is because of direct perception. Second is parokshata. Parokshata is a sense of otherness. And again, they are connected. You can see directly something that is other than you only. At the relative level, we are talking about world. We are not talking about the truth here. You are seeing the names and forms. Why you are seeing the names and forms directly? Because they are other than you. Isn't it? So even if the thoughts, if you take the thoughts, you take the emotions, you take the breath, you take the body, everything is known. How it is known? Because it is separate from you. It is not you. That is why it is known. at the thought level, isn't it? Parokshata. Then parichinnata, that which is limited is an illusion. That which is divided is an illusion. That which is, these are the two, parichinnata is these two. These two words you can explain with that. So that which is divided. Is the water divided? No. But the wave is feeling that I am a wave and there is another wave. You are feeling that I have got a hand, I am a body, I am the breath, I am the mind, I am the intellect. Within yourself you have created so many divisions. And what is the truth? In which the sajatiya bhed, vijatiya bhed and swagata bhed, all the bhedas, all the differences are absent. So these three things. Why world is an illusion? The world is an illusion because we can perceive it directly with our eyes. Second, we have a sense of otherness with respect to the world. Third, it is parichinnata, that it is parichinna, that it is divided. That one, it seems to be, nothing is, like you see the waters, they are one. Can you see, you say the world, but what is this world made up of? You see so many variety, isn't it? You can't, when you look at the world, you can only see one thing that is common. Denominator, that also only some people, and that is space. Just like when you see the water, what is the common denominator? Water. So there you can come to know. I'm just taking as a simile here. So you are seeing the waves, but you are seeing the water. But when we are seeing the world, can we see the truth? Therefore, it is an illusion. So pratyakshata, parokshata and parichinnata. And then it says here, are to be reassessed on the basis of the authority of scriptures, logically understood and practically experienced, how all these three in your experience are only delusory, because of delusion, because of non-apprehension of the reality, we are seeing the world of names and forms and missing the point. And therefore, here he says that when this is not appreciated, the wrong meaning of mithya or illusion takes the position of one's understanding. So when we are saying illusion, we mean by these three points. But we also, when Adi Shankaracharya is mithya, he is talking about that which is coming and going. In that general, every time he is not going to justify himself why he is saying that. In his Prakaran Granthas, he has already explained. In Vivek Chudamani, he has in detail explained what is mithya. Even chapter 13 Bhagavad Gita, we are saying, there also Adi Shankaracharya's, Vedvyasji's commentary there. There also we see all that is changing, all that is limited, all that is conditioned, all that is an illusion or mithya. But because it is mithya does not mean that truth is absent there. How is truth present there? As existence. It is nothing can be outside of truth. Even ignorance cannot be outside of truth. Even illusion, delusion, nothing can be outside of truth. And that is the ultimate, that our goal is, that we are that. So which where we were in this? We were on the fifth point, and here we were seeing that which is called as Maya with reference to conditioning at totality level for Ishvara is avidya or ajnana at the individuality level. This conditioning of jiva does not speak of absence of knowledge but incompleteness of knowledge. Where does it say that? In the Jnaneshwara commentary, he does not take it as absence of knowledge. What is absence of knowledge equal to? Ignorance. Here he says it is incompleteness of knowledge. Nobody has doubt that they are existing. Nobody has a doubt. But what is their essential nature? That is that they are missing. Are they a father? Are they a son? Where do we get the stress from in trying to juggle the roles of our life, isn't it? And then on top of that, when we come to Vedanta, we are told you are not a body also. Or not another thing to juggle with. Huh? You are not the mind also. You are not the breath also. You keep working it out. So here it is. So wherever you are, wherever your attention is, that becomes your reality. If my attention is on the children, my reality will be a father. If my attention is on the body, my attention will be, my reality will be, I am the soul, I am the jivatma. When my attention is on the truth, then reality is as it is, isn't it? So where is our attention? And this is the game of spirituality. If you don't want to get under the clutches of Maya, here he says incomplete knowledge. Incomplete knowledge will be yours as long as your contemplation is on anything other than the truth. The untruth, the changing, the world can never give you. As long as your obsession is with the name and form and with understanding through thoughts, you can never come to know the truth. But having said that, that is your blanket foundation, understanding. Now, because of these names and forms and the world, you know that there is only, you have sussed it out that there is only one truth. Huh? Because scriptures are saying so. Then why am I not experiencing it? Because of your obsession. Because of your obsession. So logically, look at this text or various different scriptures. When we go through them systematically, they melt away, dissolve away all the multiplicity. They make us, because you have to be convinced, you think you are intelligent. Every one of us thinks we are intelligent, but that intelligence is foolish because it is keeping us in the loop of multiplicity and duality, isn't it? So that is not intelligence. Intelligence is that which is your nature. It is not at the thought level. And how to go beyond thought and how to go beyond the mind? By being the intelligence itself. But we keep thinking that thinking through thoughts, I can purify myself, I can, yes, to some extent, yes, but eventually you will have to give up the thought also. And then the complete knowledge will dawn. It's not that you will gain, it will dawn upon you. It will be a revelation. It will be where there was an individual, there alone the infinite will start expressing. It is not a separate thing to... Then why, if it is already there, why am I not experiencing it? Because of our obsession with the mind, because of our obsession with the world. What disposition comes because you take the world to be real and the body, breath, mind, intellect to be real? A sense of doership. I need to do something in order to realize. Realization is very simple. Stop and remain awake. But we don't know how to stop. When we stop, we go to sleep. We are asking you, stop and remain awake. That that is the issue which is keeping us from gaining the complete knowledge of the truth, the sense of doership. Drop it. So that only by exposing yourself, your mind, continuously to the systematic thought unfoldment, logical unfoldment with faith, that what scriptures are telling, what teachers are telling is the correct one, correct thing. They are not trying to take us for a ride. The scriptures are not taking us for a ride. They have our best in their heart. They want us to realize. They want you to know what the truth is. And in that journey, they themselves say that we cannot tell you the truth. We can only indicate it. You have to realize it. And in the same vein, they say, it is a realization, it's an experienceless experience, it's a knowing less knowing. Because if they say anything conclusively, then it becomes a concept in the mind, in the intellect. And truth is beyond the intellect. Even though pervading the intellect, but our obsession with thoughts, that has to be weaned away. And that happens with contradictory language. Because we understand only through language. And therefore, here when we say complete knowledge, which is the truth, or Maya is incomplete knowledge. Why incomplete knowledge? Only because you don't know what the complete knowledge is, which is your own essential nature. So here, the sadhana indicated by Shankara Vedanta is, first, growing out of the influence of the world by accepting it as an illusion, that is, the sense of otherness about the world is not correct. Therefore, there is no need to struggle for the worldly achievements or failures. This is the first point. What I was telling you, that your sense of doership, I need to achieve, I need to be successful. Once I have secured my future, then I will go into spirituality. So many people tell us that. I was also like that once upon a time. Till by grace it clicked. Sometimes those type of thoughts do come. I'm not going to deny. But then that's why continuous involvement with scriptures keeps us on the right path, with the right goalpost in front, that I must not get caught up in anything. Otherwise goal is there and I'm hitting the ball that way. That's what we are all doing. Goal is inside and I am trying to catch it out there. Isn't it? Even though it is there plentily, abundantly, but we don't have the vision to access it. Why? Because our obsession is with the variety. So where do we catch it? Where do we access it? Within ourselves. First, you have to wean yourself away. Jnaneshwar Maharaj takes a different approach. He says, forget about weaning away this and that. Just accept it, man. Because he's talking his experience of realization. He's not being a teacher to mold your mind slowly and unfold the truth to you. He's not into that. This text is about his experience of realization. It is not a treatise to like Vivek Chudamani. It is explaining to you, now you discriminate, now Vivek, Vairagya, Shatka Sampatti, Mukshutvam. He says, forget all that. Everything is that only. Straight away, the highest standpoint. Everything that he is saying in this text is from the absolute standpoint. Then you will ask, from absolute standpoint, there is no need to use the words. Who are you to say that? If the whole world can express as this variety, the truth can express as this in infinite variety, why can't it express as these words of the Master? It is his nectar which is flowing out. Amrit is nectar. It is his nectar which is flowing out. So here he says, See, every sadhana, whether you take yoga sutras, the, what is the first in the shat, you know, the 8 steps, what are the first? Yama and Niyama. What is Yama and Niyama? That you do not get disturbed by the world, nor do you disturb the world. How do you disturb the world? Through activity. Where is the activity? Manasa, Vacha, Kaya. So how do we get disturbed by the world? By actions of other people, by the speech of other people, by the thoughts of other people. If they are strong enough, they can affect you. Same way, how do you affect, disturb the world? Again, by these three. So the first step when they say practice Yama is control this. Don't disturb nor get disturbed. Create a buffer zone. How do you do all that? You know, practice non-violence and aparigraha. That is, there are 10 points or 5 points. So you practice all that. Asteya, non-stealing, truthful speaking and non-violence. And so you practice that. So slowly, slowly you will fall into that zone, that where nothing is disturbing in the world. So same here. First become convinced that there is nothing to achieve in this world. World is as it is. If I don't have to achieve in the world, then what do I do? See, the question comes, then what do I do? Because of your addiction to doing. Then what do I do? Do nothing. How do I do that? Again, problem. How do I do nothing?
Can't get away from doing.
You understand how we have trained ourselves to get caught up in this. And therefore we find it so painful or so difficult and to wean our mind away from that which has become so deeply entrenched in our psyche, the doing. Ego functions as a doer and enjoyer. It's not going to let go that easily. It, until and unless ego is given a chocolate, that there is a higher goal. Yes, you be involved in doing, you be involved in thinking, but has this thinking given you any peace and tranquility till now? No. But I can assure, you are training the mind that if you think in this manner, as the scriptures are saying, you will be permanently at peace. That's what you are looking at, no? You want to be the most powerful, you want to have a unending bliss, you want to have all the knowledge, and you are trying to get that through the world, but till now, have you got it? No. Then don't you think you are going wrong somewhere? You are talking to your mind or the ego. Don't you think you are going wrong somewhere? Yes. Then is there any solution? Yes, come to the scriptures. And then reformation begins. And it's still because of the old habit, it keeps going in that direction, but as long as you keep interacting on a regular basis with the scriptures, slowly, slowly the U-turn happens. And when that U-turn happens, and when he reaches means as he gets as the past gets purified and the doership becomes less and less, he starts understanding, then what is realization? Realizing that I was already that. And that is not a thought, a realization. It's not a realization through thought. It is as it is then. See? And so it is our incomplete knowledge about ourselves which is keeping us in this loop of the world. And here the teacher says, therefore, there is no need to struggle. Stop struggling. Struggling creates friction. Where there is friction, as I told you, do nothing. But wherever there is doership, there is energy expended. If I'm moving this hand, if I'm speaking, this is action going on. How much can I speak? Maybe if I'm so inspired, I can speak for 2, 3, 4 hours. After that, I'll get exhausted. So whether you are expending energy at the physical level or the speech level or thinking level, contemplation. See, when we do, in this book there is a chapter called on the speech. Eh? And in that speech, it is this, the journey of the speech is Vaikari Madhyama Pashyanti Para. So this is the journey from gross speech to transcendental speech. And what is transcendental speech? Silence. So how to get there? It is not told. First thing is, you just be that, but you can't. You are so addicted to activity. So they say, okay, you start chanting the mantra. What? Aum. You keep chanting loudly, not in your mind, loudly. After you get exhausted chanting and you are pushing Aum, Aum, with feeling, with understanding and everything, eventually, when everything stops disturbing you around you, automatically that sound Om will become, first you are chanting Om, Om, then it will become Om, Om, then this will also stop, then that will also stop, it will become Ajapajap, then that will also stop, it will become unexpressed Om, but you are awake. Now when you are gone back, you are going back to the source of the Om. Om, and what is the source? The conscious principle, isn't it? Without conscious principle, how the Om will be expressing? Oh, no, but Om was there before I was born and Om will be there after I die. Your attention is not on Om, your attention is on your body. See how we get caught up in the trap? So, the weaning away should be so gentle and so elegant and so effortless. But that effortlessness you will access only when you put efforts. You have to give 110%. Then you will fall into that zone. Have you noticed when you are, how should I say, you know, when these athletes, they have to go for their races and everything, they keep how many years they practice, isn't it? And when that D-Day comes, they have practiced it so many times to get into that zone, to get into that zone. Allow, and you will see, everyone has a different way. Someone does like this, someone looks up, someone shakes himself, and then they take the position on your, and they get into the zone. Because they don't want to be the owner of the body when the gun goes. If they have to be sprinting, they don't want, if they take the ownership of the body will not move. Yes, they have to begin with ownership, but very quickly they have to get into the zone so that body propels of its own accord because of the training that they have done. Same thing is with us also. So efforts lead to effortlessness. You also put efforts to go to bed, go to sleep. But when sleep comes, it's effortless, isn't it? Efforts lead to effortlessness. And in every, whether you were a wife or a husband or a mother or a father, whether it was a new job or it was a new skill or it was a new profession, initially it is very difficult. But if your heart is in the right place, you will put all your energy in it and then after that, enjoy the ride. Because you have become expert at that field, expert at that job, isn't it? And every now and then, you keep fine-tuning it. But now, that fine-tuning is not hard work. Understand? So, same way here also. When we look at this, oh, Bap re, such a thick book, how many years again it will take? I never approached this text for so many years. It was lying, it was there in the room. But it has to come from inside for me. So we are studying so that we, all our our knowledge becomes complete about our essential nature. So here Swamiji says the second point, the sadhana is the sense of limitation accepted on account of annamaya, pranamaya, manomaya kosha is conquered by the invocation of a temporary individuality. So instead of focusing and living your life at the level of body, breath, mind, intellect, start living at the individuality level, at the conscious level. This is also majority are not doing, and sometimes we forget because of our old habits. So what is prompting all the activities in your, what quality of activity is going on in your life? And you can look at a person and straight away tell, but you have to develop that acumen. And that is, if someone is only into, okay, let's not go into too much detail, but everything that is happening, if your attention is on the body, your attention will go into what can bring comfort to the body, isn't it? What if your attention is on the breath, what are the shad urmis? At the body level, it is comfort, discomfort, or heat and cold. Those are the disturbances. At the level of breath, it is hunger and thirst. At the level of mind is likes and dislikes, which lead to joys and sorrows. And at the level of, this is where they stop, but we add one more, intellect. That is praise and insult. Okay. So now, where are you? If someone has said anything and you got hurt, oh, that person should not have said like that, he should not have behaved like that. Understand, you are attached to your intellect. If, oh my God, it's so cold, you are at a body level. Ah, I did not drink a glass of milk before coming here, and now my stomach is making guru, 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 guru. I should have eaten. Oh my God, now I can't concentrate. Your attention is on the breath, pranamaya kosh. And someone gives you milk at a particular temperature, which is neither hot nor cold. And you say, no, I like hot milk. You are at the mind level. Because like has come. I don't drink lukewarm milk. I like hot milk. So like has come. I like my seat. I like my cushion. I like this. I like that. So gone. So recognize this. So instead of living at these levels, bring your attention to the conscious principle. Who is this fellow who is functioning, who is saying it is, I don't like this? By default, you will speak that way. But our attention, if we do enough practice to come to the individuality, which is the conscious principle, which is individual only at this moment, then who is this fellow who is saying that there is heat and cold? Who is this fellow who is saying there is hunger and thirst? Who is this fellow who is having the likes and... Who is taking this ownership? Who is this fellow? I am that. But which I? Is it the father I? Is it the brother I? Is it the body I? Is it the breath I? Is it the hungry I? It is the seeing, hearing, touching, feeling, tasting I? Is it the thinking I? Is it the stupid I? It is the intelligent I? Which I? This also I know. So we shift our attention from the conditionings to the conditioned. This is the second step. This is another exercise. The next one. Individually at the Vigyanmaya Kosha level. So when you consume, and how do you know that there is? Because you keep saying for everything, I. What is this I? So where are you now? Your attention is like Ravana Maharishi. Who am I? But ours is very superficial at this moment. We say, who am I? I am saying it, but there are so many words and still so many loose ends that there is no, it's a joke. So don't compare yourself to Ramana Maharishi. You have to find your own journey. Goal, destination will be the same, but your journey will be the most unique. It cannot be what Dr. Ravi is going through, or Ravi cannot go through what you are going through, because you are two unique individuals made up, and your mind is made up, is a unique mind. The principle of individuality is the same, and that's where we want to focus. Not on the changing. We want to focus on the sense of individuality. And how do you know? As I. So find out, who is this? Is this I bound in any way, at any time, at all? Or is it just a figment of imagination that it is bound? And once you start studying the scriptures, everything starts unfolding. So here the next one says, inquiry into the nature of this jiva to discover the substratum supporting the limitations of the panchakoshas. And the more we keep focus, remember I told you, by thinking, you cannot stop thinking. But that is the only choice we have, because we don't know how to be. So if that is the way, instead of thinking by so many words, now from all the different words, concepts, ideas, I have come to the I thought, and I'm asking again and again. It's difficult, it's painful, my mind wants to pull me back into variety, but I am again and again, who am I? Who is this I? Who is having this experience? I want to know as it is, as he is. And the more you keep focusing on it, suddenly you come to realize that you are not the body, breath, mind, intellect. You are not the panchakoshas. See, this will be possible only when mind is purified. So just like when you keep thinking without any distraction about sleep, what happens? How does your mind get purified to be absorbed into the void called sleep, so that you can experience bliss? How does it happen? If there are too many thoughts in your mind, you cannot sleep. But when you, in spite of the thoughts, your attention is on the sleep, the world starts dropping the mind. The thoughts start dissolving. The world is still there at that, because you are still awake. But it is not able to influence you, it is not able to affect you, it is not able to disturb you, it is not able to agitate you, it is not able to frustrate you. All the conditions are still there, but you have become immune. Why you have become immune? Not because you intelligently became immune to it. No, because you focused on the sleep with more intention and love than the world. Therefore, it became immune. Urvarukameva bandhanat. And then a certain point comes where you get sucked into the sleep. Exactly the same way it is on this eye also. You have to, why it is not happening? Because you are not generating enough faith, enough love, enough commitment, enough dedication to continuously contemplate on this eye. When you do it, Urvarukameva bandhanat. What is Urvarukameva bandhanat? Every thought, every concept, every emotion, every name and form, every experience, interaction, event, situation that you think thought was essential for your existence, it will start falling away. Why? Your focus is the I. This is the third step. Third step. First the world, then coming to the I, then remaining focused on the I, and coming to such a level, what will be the consequence? You will come to realize that you are not making the body act. You are not making the senses function. You are not making the mind think. You are not making the intellect conceptualize. They are happening, they are doing it of their own accord. That happens where? It happens at the heart chakra. In this, in Kashmiri Shaivism, the chakra system is there. So where it happens? It happens at the heart chakra, where consciousness and matter are separate, becomes your direct experience. it becomes your direct experience at the heart chakra. Till before, Muladhar, Manipur, Swadhisthan and Manipur, it's security, desire and accumulation, greed. When you rise, and what? Where is these three? It's only in the world, isn't it? When you rise above it, how do you rise above it? Either you chant the name of the Lord or you hear Swamiji saying, contemplate on the I. It will happen. How will it happen? That's not your concern. You, if you keep thinking why it has not happened, then you are generating more thoughts in your mind. Abandon. Live in abandonment. So, inquiry into the nature of this jiva to discover the substratum supporting the limitations of the panchakoshas. So, here we are able to subtly understand the purport of the scriptures, which was, it was very gross, it was very confusing. Now, everything you hear and it clicks, yes, that's right, because your attention is not on the world, but it is on the I. You have already weaned away. And now everything, all the puzzle is starting to come together. The first step of that puzzle coming together, the first vision that, oh, I got the first, I think this is the head, this is the hand, this is the tail of this. Ah, now slowly, slowly I can expand it. So what is the first? That consciousness and matter are separate. This I, the consciousness, till now which thought that it was the body, breath, mind, intellect, on inquiry comes to realize that it was never married to the matter. Never. It seems that it is married, but no. Kshetra, kshetrajnya. Then the result of this is conquering the limitations of jiva jagat ishvara bheda, the differentiation of reality on account of the conditionings of the individual world and the creator, and leading life thereafter as a jivan mukta purusha. Jivan mukti is an expression of the infinite through finite conditionings without the influence of the limitations of these conditions. How beautiful. Again, contradictory language. So, what is the first? The result of this is conquering the limitation of jiv jagat. So, when we come to inquire into the nature of this I, of this conscious principle, which we have come to know is not the body, breath, mind, intellect, because they are changing. And here, you can come to this anahat chakra through pranayam, through japa. You don't have to study scriptures to get there. Very easily, and this clarity becomes self-evident. But then scriptures will have to come into your life. Why? Not will have to, I'm being too strong here. No, will have to. Grace can do wonders. Many of them have not ever studied any scriptures. So many Mahatmas are there. All they have done is held on to the name of the Lord, they have held on to the thought of I. Where Raman Maharishi studied any scriptures? He studied scriptures after he realized, isn't it? Where will have to study? Nothing like that. So, but as you come to this I, and your focus is only the I, as long as you're in the mind, there is a sense of individuality and totality. But when your focus is on the I, you bypass totality. You are weaning yourself away from individuality. How did you do that? By realizing that you are not the body, breath, mind, intellect. The moment you say that you come to this realization that you are not the body, breath, mind, intellect, at that very moment you have also discarded the totality. So in Vedanta, we bypass the Ishvara to come to realize the Brahman. We are talking about Shankar Vedanta, na, here. So how do you checkmate Maya? That's what we are doing. That is what spirituality is. How do you checkmate Maya? Not by thinking about Maya, by thinking about the conscious, the unchanging. And that conscious, the unchanging, ever present in everyone's experience from childhood till today is the I. Find out who this, what is the real nature of this I. And as long as your attention is again and again on the I, you will come to the same conclusion. And as a result, the individual conditioning of one body, one breath, one mind, one intellect, all this, or the total body, total breath, total mind, total intellect, if there is something like that. As long as you are focusing on the consciousness, you bypass all this. You go beyond. Because your focus is not on individual and total. Your focus is not on how would be Sahasra Shirsha Purusha. You will get a headache if you start thinking how, if you are thinking in images or trying to conceptualize how that one reality is expressing through infinite one, through infinite variety. You can't work it out. It has to be a revelation. And without purification, your revelation will not come. And purification will come only when you are single-pointed. And now it all depends what you are single-pointed on. You become single-pointed on a profession, you will excel it. Seekers become single-pointed on the I. Because that will give us a permanent solution. That's why. So science, the technology is the same. But where your attention is, here it is told, if you want permanent peace, tranquility, experience the nectar of immortality, then attention has to be on the I. So this is how the person goes beyond the reaches the Jivan Mukta stage, and then the Jivan Mukta is the expression of the infinite through finite conditionings. So don't stop there. Through finite conditionings, without the influence of the limitation of these conditions. Now this experience also you are having, but it's incomplete. You are also expressing through the conditionings of through the finite conditionings. You are getting influenced by the finite conditionings, isn't it? Body is affecting you, breath is affecting, hunger, thirst, heat, cold, likes, dislikes, concepts, notions, ideas, creativity, doership, etc. All those things are affecting you here because you are allowed it. Is there any way that I can function through this without getting affected by this? Is there any moment in your life when it has happened like that? I'm asking.
When you are thinking about something else single-pointedly, you may not. I wouldn't worry about what's happening.
What's happening around, isn't it? Yes. You worry about it only when your attention goes there. But if your attention is steadfast on the I, on the conscious principle, then let hell break loose. Who cares, isn't it? When you are going to sleep, another example, again the same example, but in a different context, you are so focused on the sleep, so much wanting to be absorbed by it, that whatever issues, whatever anger, whatever unfinished businesses are there, you just transcend it all. Why? It's not that you make a decision to let them go. We say, let go. You cannot let go anything in this life. Very difficult. Almost an impossibility. You have to grow out of it. And the only way you can grow out of it is when your attention is on something higher. Or wherever your absolute attention is, to the exclusion of that, everything else will drop away. Just like in sleep. And same thing happens here when you are focusing on the I single-pointedly, then everything else other than the conscious principle starts losing its impact, losing its influence on the I. So this I is attached to body, gross body, subtle body, causal body, it is called individual. Now you have started, the intellect has started inquiring into its own. Who is this I? Because I expresses in the intellect. So then you can say, Annamaya Kosh, Pranamaya Kosh, Manomaya Kosh, Vigyanamaya Kosh. So he starts inquiring. And as he starts inquiring, automatically the weaning starts happening. And he realizes that he is not the equipment. Where it happens? In the heart chakra. Automatic it happens. You don't have to, all you have to do is bring the focus to the I. The ego. Ego is this finger, no? So you bring it to the I. And if you, at that much we have to do, nobody else can do it for us. So now this was Maya according to Shankar Vedanta, and we not only talked about Maya, but we also, Swamiji showed us the sadhana according to it. Now, Advaya Ishwaravad. This Advaya Ishwaravad is from the Kashmiri Shaivism, Natha Sampradaya, to which our Jnaneshwar Maharaj belongs. So here it says, the Advaya Ishwaravad is known differently as Kashmiri Shaivism, Natha Sampradaya, Pratyabhijna Shastra, Chidvilas, Trik Shastra, and Mysticism. We will take a detailed account of this approach to non-dual truth, as Sant Jnaneshwar Maharaj basically belonged to Natha Sampradaya, to this tradition. And in this, there are different terms. Now, these terms are which we have never heard in in Shankar Vedanta, but there is a corresponding name of the same thing in Shankar Vedanta. We know it in a different way. That's all. The first here taken is Paramashiva. Paramashiva is the non-dual reality inherently associated with the infinite power or potentiality, but the potentiality remains completely undifferentiated. This principle is referred to as Parabrahma in the Upanishads terminology. It is also called the Paramatma, Bhagwan in different contexts. So Paramashiva of Kashmiri Shaivism is the Paramatma or the Brahman of the Vedanta. Aitreya Upanishad declares, Om Atma Va Idamekam Eva Gre Asit. Om. And it continues. Atma Apnote Atteva Para Sarvajna Sarvashakti Ashanayadi Sarva Samsara Dharma Varjitaha Nitya Shuddha Buddha Mukta Swabhavaha Ajaha Ajaraha Amaraha Amrutaha Abhayaha Advayaha Vai Idam. What is too small? Idam yad uktam nama rupa karma bheda bhinnam jagad atma eva ekaha agre jagataha srushte prag asit. This comes in the Katho Upanishad. What is that? Aitreya Upanishad Bhashya. The Shankar Bhashya it comes. In this commentary on this mantra, Bhagavan Shankaracharya explains the word atma as the derived from the three roots. Apa, to persuade, other, to eat, ata, unbroken knowledge. This self is free from the manifest plurality of the world. The jivas, the Ishwara, the jiva and the Ishwara, the creator. Therefore, Paramashiva or Brahman are referring to that which is beyond reference of the world and its creation, etc. So there is no word which can reach it. It is the absolute. Parama is the absolute. So when we talk of the word Brahman or we talk of the word Paramashiva, these two, Paramashiva, suddenly because Shiva is said, immediately Jatadhari Shiva comes in our mind. No. It is not. It is complete. But and what is his disposition, that his infinite potentiality is remaining unexpressed. Only when it expresses, it becomes Shiva Shakti. Or in Vedanta, we say Ishvara Maya. So who is Brahman and who is Paramashiva? Where this infinite potentiality, his infinite Shakti, is remaining unmanifested. So if it is unmanifest, in Shankar Vedanta, we come to wrong conclusions, incomplete knowledge again, and that is, now because it has expressed and it has become Ishvara and Prakriti, then Prakriti, is, Maya has gone through Sattva, Rajas, Tamas, and the world comes out and we start thinking that this is a problem and I have to focus on the Ishvara. But we forget that Maya is part and parcel of the Ishvara itself, isn't it? So they have not become separated, and that's what. So where Shankaracharya approaches, and from where our Natha Sampradaya or Kashmiri Shaivism approaches is a different take on it. They are talking about the same thing, but there is a different take. Just like you are there and he calls you wife and you are the same. Another person calls you mother. Person is same. See? The person is same, but depending upon who is calling you, they are putting a connotation on you. Isn't it? Same way. From one angle, Shankaracharya is looking, he is talking about the same thing, but it's the word usage. Like our Aurobindo, he uses the words consciousness, supra consciousness, supra consciousness. The words are different, but he is also talking about the same thing. So same way here, therefore the Paramashiva or Brahman are referring to that which is beyond reference of the world and its creation. So, yato vacho nivartante aprapya manasa saha is the disposition of Brahman. You cannot come to know it through thoughts, through ideas, through concepts, through emotions, through activity, through thinking. No, it is beyond. You cannot come to know at some place, at some time, in some temple. No. Because he's everywhere. There's no special condition required. And recognize that is Param Shiva. He is the substratum. He is all that there is. It's transcendental to everything, even though supporting everything. Why are we saying supporting everything? Because we are talking from individual standpoint. But we are using the word, he is everything, but we don't understand what that word means. Because we have got no experience how something can support everything. We don't know. And then we give you an example. Gold is supporting all the ornaments. Water is supporting all the waves. I understood. You have got no understanding still. Because you are seeing it objectively, you can never understand. It comes close, it gives you an idea, but it is not it. Because you are still in concepts. Gold behind ornaments is you have created a concept of it. Water behind waves, you have created a concept of it. It's an objective experience. This is not an objective experience. So here, Swamiji continues, the creation which does not impose any covering on Paramashiva or Brahman is called as Shuddha Adhyana. What is it? Mereko dikh nahi raha hai. Shuddha Adhyana in Shaiva philosophy and in Natha Sampradaya and Ishwara Srishti in Shankara Vedanta. So, Ishvara Srishti or Shuddha Advana is the one and the same thing. First, we will take this aspect of universality in creation. First is Shiva Tattva. So, what is Shiva Tattva? What is Shakti Tattva? Without understanding these basics, very difficult to understand what the text proper is going to be. Shiva Tattva. Parama Shiva is associated with its infinite, unmanifest Shakti. When some of this infinite potentialities are invoked for creation, it is called as Shiva Tattva. Parama Shiva is ever complete. It has Purnamada, Purnamidam. And understand, when something is created out of this complete principle, it remains is also complete, and what comes out is also complete, because completeness never gets corrupted. So, Parama Shiva is the complete principle, and that Parama Shiva now creates, invokes his potentiality. Why? It is all, everything is possible within it. But while all possibilities are within it, it does not become two. So when potentiality was, in his infinite potentiality was unmanifest, he is called by one person, one name. So is in a girl motherhood inherent? But it is not unmanifest, isn't it? At a particular time it will get manifest. You don't have to do anything to manifest it. The potentiality is there. And when that potentiality expresses itself, then that girl is not called a spinster, she is called a mother. Isn't it? Exactly the same way. The Parama Shiva, when he, out of his own free will, that is the nature of his, he manifests the potentiality, now he is called, in Shankara Vedanta, he is called Ishvara and Prakriti. In Shaiva Siddhanta, it is called as Shiva Shakti. Two. So here. So when some of this infinite potentialities are invoked for creation, who invokes? Can Prakriti invoke? Can Prakriti invoke? No. Only the conscious principle can invoke. Yeah. Because he is the intelligent principle. It is called as Shiva Tattva. So, with respect to his, when he becomes, when the Parama Shiva becomes conscious of his infinite potentiality of creation, he is called Shiva Tattva. Before that, he was the undivided, homogeneous Parama Shiva Tattva. Therefore, the first spandana in Parama Shiva qualifies it and is called as Shiva Tattva. This is the first throb. Throb is spandana. So, in Kriya Yoga and Kundalini Yoga, we catch this throb and go back to the source. And you can catch the throb at the Mooladhar, at the different chakras. And as it passes through the various chakras, this throb purifies every chakra. And the entire creation is distributed according to the Varnamala along the six chakras. And all the alphabets of the Devanagari script, they are distributed along the six chakras. Matrukavarna. And as this throb keeps going back, as long as your attention is on the infinite, it will go up. You've got no choice. It has got no choice. It keeps purifying. So, as purification means, now it is not susceptible to disturbance on account of the creation at that expresses at the chakra level. So here, anyway, we have come down too far. We are only at the Shiva level right now. So the Paramashiva becoming conscious or invoking his own potentiality, now he is no longer, even though Paramashiva is always, but with respect to that potentiality, he is called as Shiva Tattva. Absolutely, absolutely.
So Ishvara and Shiva Tattva is
same. Because who is Ishvara? Ishvara is he who is not affected by his own prakriti, his potentiality. Who is Ishvara? Who is ever conscious of his essence? He is ever conscious of his essence, and that is the reason he is the master of Maya. The day he forgets that, he is called an individual. The moment he forgets, takes the attention away from his essential nature, where will the attention go? Somewhere. It will go on the Maya. And when it goes on the Maya, if he remains uninfluenced by Maya, still okay. But if he gets identified with Maya and starts thinking that I am it, individuality precipitates. Witnessing is the place where he is not, he is aware that the prakriti is there, but he is not influenced by the prakriti when he is the witness. And this is how, anyway, we'll talk about it. This Shiva Tattva is referred to in the aforesaid mantra of Aitreya Upanishad by the word sa ikshata. Here sa refers to Shiva Tattva and ikshana refers to the Shakti Tattva. Now naturally in the next question will be, what is Shakti Tattva? We also know in our life, when we observe ourselves, there is something called body and there is something called life expressing, isn't it? We know that a person dies, something is missing from that person. So that which is missing is the, our understanding is so gross. In other words, in these words, it is so incomplete that we say that it is missing. What it is the manifest, the ability of the equipment to support the manifestation of that infinite has gone. Has the truth gone? Has the infinite gone? No. The ability of the equipment, like if the engine conks off in your car, the ability of the engine to convert the petrol and electricity into horsepower, that has finished. You can keep punching the accelerator as much as you want. You can keep starting. Car will not go anywhere. Then what do? You discard it. Get a new car. That is death of the car. Go to junkyard now. Take the car to the junkyard. Same thing is here. But that does not mean because the car has gone to the junkyard, the driver also has become junk. No. Driver is still independent of the vehicle. Exactly the same way. So, recognize this, and eventually you have to recognize, according to Ishvara Advayavad, you have to recognize, or the realization comes, that there is nothing coming and going. There is nothing manifesting, unmanifesting. Everything is that the play of Shiva and Shakti. Everything is a play of that. We feel there is knowledge has become less, knowledge has become more. Waking, dreaming, deep sleep, the whole Leela. Jnaneshwar Maharaj takes the approach of the whole thing as Leela. That is Ishvara Advayavad. So now Shakti Tattva. Already, we'll leave it next week. So in Shakti, so what are the different types of Shaktis? That is explained, we'll explain all that. And
I'm reading that.
So come to this so what did we understand today? That Shiva Tattva, Parama Shiva, with the first spandan, with the first movement, with the first desire, if we may call it, he is no longer called as Shiva Tattva, he is called as Shiva Tattva, who is aware of his potentiality, the Shakti. So that is the, and it is the same, Brahman becoming aware of his potentiality is called Ishvara with respect to his potentiality called Maya. It's unmanifest. All he has done is he has become aware. That's all. And this you can experience every morning also when you get up. When you are in the bed, you have become awake and thoughts have not started. The world hasn't entered. But you are there. Mind is absolutely empty for few seconds. For some it is longer. So before you were in ignorant sleep, now you have become conscious, but you are not conscious of anything. You are just conscious that you are. At that moment, the world has not come. All the things to do, now to do this, now to do that, that has not. You are aware that you are there. Even the thought of body has not come into your mind. It's for a split of a second. That is because nothing that is happening at the totality level is not happening at the micro level. It has to be the same. It cannot be divorced from, because it's part and parcel of the same, isn't it? So what do Mahatmas do? They catch that. They catch that point. They be that point where. So in the previous, in Shankar Vedanta, the last line was told, a Jivan Mukta Purusha is the infinite reality functioning through individual equipment without getting influenced by individual equipment, isn't it? That's exactly the same thing. At that moment, early in the morning, you are in the body for everyone, but you are influenced by body, breath, mind, intellect at that moment. When you are in samadhi, you are expressing through this body, but you are not affected by the body, breath, mind, intellect, or the world at large. Understand? So their focus is that. Our focus is the world. And therefore we are never able to understand what they are going through. Even scriptures cannot understand what they are going through. They cannot understand. They can give you some idea of what their disposition is of the Mahatmas, but they cannot conclusively tell that it is like this or it is like that. Because scriptures are not for the Mahatmas. Scriptures are for us.
Scriptures are validated.
Validated by the life, by the disposition of Mahatmas. So no Mahatma will ever say scriptures are wrong. Because they have come to that conclusion, because they completely have faith that the scriptures are the speech of the divine, revealed to the world so that the world can come to recognize they are also of that divine nature. And who can take you there? Only the scriptures. Which scriptures unambiguously take you there? The Vedas. Among the Vedas, the Upanishads. Or our words, like this text, which is the speech of the realized master, they can also take you there. So we will see the Shakti Tattva in our next class. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om. Just sit quietly for a minute.